like Brady's arms.
Oh, this crowd is awesome. You guys are awesome.
So, first of all, thank you for coming back to Salt Lake.
Yeah, second time here. I mean, I'll tell you what, if they can make 9 foot tall talking turtles, they can make that, right? Also, if they can wipe out all the times that I laughed during Casey and John Barrowman, and this guy, they can handle the 8-pack.
Awesome.
All right, well, they're the real deal. They're the real deal.
Oh, yeah. Makes you sick every time. We're going to go over the questions, so to start lining up, we're dead in the center, so let's do this.
So my first question is for Steven. How did you think about all the Queen in season one and then season five? How did he change and did you think he changed for the better or the worse?
I think that he changed the way that people change in life, which is that you add certain good qualities and you pick up certain bad qualities. One of the things that I really enjoyed about season five is that in the flashbacks, I'm playing a version of Oliver that is remarkably close to the version of me in season one, and it's been fun to go back there. Meanwhile, they've been joking in the writer's room and talking with the EPs that amongst the group, the team, as it were, Oliver at the moment is sort of the optimist. So I'm happy with where he is right now. I think it's in a good spot. And be honest, did you ever actually play the original Nintendo? Okay.
Hi, my name's Esty.
So,
so my question is, I love your guys' work, and I'm also a really big fan of the show Flash. So I was wondering, what has been your favorite episode, like, to do with their cast? Because I know you guys cross over like all the time. So I was wondering, what's your favorite episode to do with them? And how is the dynamic between the two casts when they work together?
I hate them. No, we love the Flash. You know, it's weird because they're literally next door. Like, they're on the other side of the wall. They're that close to us. I mean, they're truly our neighbors.
But there is also an element of their cast that is reflective of their show, which is to say that they are bright and cheery and sing-alongs. Shut up, let's get to work, shut up.
They also work like 8-hour days or 7-hour days. We work like 16-hour days. So Flash, you're soft. Soft, man, print it!
I think the first time that, you know, you get to, that we all got to meet Barry Allen before he was in Flash, scenes like that, and the scene that I got to shoot with Grant in the Flash pilot was certainly, you know, enjoyable and felt epic and all those things. But my favorite scene is just whenever Diggle interacts with the Flash. The first time that David, you need to tell the story because none of us could keep a straight face, and David wanted to make sure that.
It's funny too because the first time I ever meet Flash, Andrew Kreisberg, producer of the show. He was sitting in Video Village where he kind of watched what's going on in front of the screen. And he was like, listen, when you see Flash, I want you to just go big. And I'm like, well, okay. So I did it, and I threw like one fry in the air or whatever. And he was like, no, like, go like crazy big, dude. Go crazy big. So I threw like all the fries in the air, and just everybody howled laughing. So the thing is now, we're doing our 8th episode is our 100th episode. Barrow is coming up there very soon. So we talked about this with the producers, and it really is a good thing. We have to, Diggle has to have a reaction to Supergirl that rivals him. So I decided that maybe he can pee just a little bit.
Thank you.
Hello. So, this question came to me in a dream last night. It was burning in my heart ever since.
Well, let's answer it before it burns it down.
I appreciate your concern. Do you prefer ravioli or SpaghettiOs?
The portions for ravioli are always too small. So my eyes focus on it on the menu, but then my heart sinks. It doesn't burn, but it sinks.
Yeah, ravioli for sure. That's what I said.
Look, we just show up where the producers tell us. That's it.
True.
Yeah.
That's true.
You know what would be fantastic? Tickle, like, playing a trumpet. You know, like, slow blues. Glasses. Smoke.
No smoke, no brandy.
If John is saying a line, he drops it. He just starts saying random stuff until he gets to the end of the speech. And it destroys
him. Yeah, no, we got, because you can see John working. For example, the camera's on him. No, the camera's on us, right? It's not on him, so he doesn't let him do any work, but he's really trying to give it his all so he can do the scene right. All he has to say is, I have to go to the store to get some milk, for example. That's all he has to say. But he can't remember it. So his camera's on us, and he's going, I have to go. Milk is what I really want to say, and store is there someplace in the line, but I'm not quite sure where it fits. And we're just like, we're dying, because he wants to help us so bad, but
yeah. And then he always, in an English accent, every once in a while, he'll say bollocks. That destroys me too. Bollocks. Oh, I miss John.
Yeah, we miss John.
Not that he hasn't been on the show.
Excluding death scenes,
emotional dialogue scene in Arrow was the hardest for you and challenged you as an actor?
Good question.
Well, it didn't directly involve a death scene, but the last scene that I shot with Susanna Thompson, who played my mom, was the scene in a way back flashback when I have just discovered that the girl that I got pregnant has lost the baby, never do that. And it was our last scene together, and both of us knew it. And the dialogue and the screen direction didn't necessarily call for the type of emotion that came forward in that scene, but we couldn't hold it back. So that scene actually ended up being something very different. And I think that it turned out great, but it was right teetering on the edge of being something that would stick out as like, that seems like it doesn't quite belong in the show or isn't what it's supposed to be. So that was certainly the toughest one for me.
Yeah, I don't know if this was tough for me, but I think it was profound in that the theme was kind of repeated throughout the show. Oddly enough, we kind of touch on it even this season to some degree. When Diggle in season one is offered by Oliver to be part of the team, and he refuses at first, comes back to the Queen Mansion and accepts the offer. And he has a very nice moment with Oliver where he talks about the fact that Oliver doesn't quite understand what taking a life does to the soul. And he needs to know that. And I think that theme was repeated throughout season one, season two, to kind of forget him. And not just through my character, but also through Elizabeth, to kind of end through his best friend Tommy's death. All these things kind of, I think, created a more well-rounded hero. And I think that was just a very important theme, also for television, also. You know, just kind of, this is vigilante justice, and what does that mean? And I think Diggle was